Relinquishing control, just getting into a state where I can truthfully answer these questions to myself, like, how do you feel right now? What's going on in your life? What's worth talking about? What's hard to explain? And just by asking myself those questions, I can begin to see colors I may want to use and images and concepts I may want to create, and sometimes even words that I may want to put in there. So that's probably the most important part of the process.
The strongest part of my creative process is taking a mental note by constantly drawing in my head throughout the day and while I sleep. I like thinking ahead, so as I begin drawing, I have an idea of what I'm going to do. But it never goes as planned. And it's the mistakes where I learn the most. Those mistakes turn into something that I would have never thought about.
An idea sparks, and I try to write it down as soon as I can. Because that's not just one idea. It's many possible concepts. And I spend a good amount of time thinking how I can build that concept. How can I change it? What colors can best express it? What should I take off? And this stage of the process might take the most amount of time, but when I start working, I know that I can go into it with confidence and I have all these ways to go about it and I can see what fits best for the final piece.
I'm definitely inspired by both of those things. One of the experiences that personally inspired me was just going to college for the first time. I'm completely unaware of what I wanted to do. And being immersed in that feeling of just anxiousness and confusion and feeling lost with what I wanted to be in the world and what I wanted to contribute to the world. And it's such a universal feeling, you know, and especially being an artist, because you don't quite know where you're gonna fit in, even in your own artistic sphere. So I created so much art during that time, just in my dorm room, allowing myself to go through those feelings and listen to them.
I feel like I am inspired by my surroundings and my personal life experiences. Specifically, I see color all the time and I'm fascinated by color. I like to work with color and through color make this high contrast within my work. So I often see this color that inspires me to start and use on my next piece, and I start creating these color schemes that go along with this color, and that's a part of inspiration to my work.
Sometimes I can be inspired by individuals in my neighborhood, a park, or in a bus, and I wonder what their stories are, and that's when I remind myself that all the people we meet or pass by have their own experiences, and they're all equally significant, and we can learn something from them.
I always get inspired by everyone around me, from the people closest to me to complete strangers. Although we may not talk about art, I enjoy interpreting our conversations about life into my art. One person I've been inspired by is my grandpa. For example, he knows little about art, but thinks like an artist. He gave me great advice about gardening once, telling me to take a moment to step back, sit down, and look. He explains this because sometimes you can just get lost in the process. I found that to be the best advice when you're head deep in a drawing and you just need to look at the whole picture.
As far as surroundings, I'm inspired by nature. I'm inspired by the colors that exist in nature, the duality of nature, the duality of the people that surround me, the people that love me, really inspire me. Can you share some of the challenges that you have faced as an artist? Yes. Some of the challenges that I have faced as an artist have been balancing creativity and productivity. Because on the one hand, if you're in that creative space, you know, where you're allowing yourself to express things free and uninhibited, oftentimes it comes sporadically and it doesn't come when you want it to, or you have to sort of, you know, be out experiencing life and experiencing things outside of yourself So a lot of times that means you're not being productive and you're not getting as much as you want to get done because you need to be having those experiences. And then on the other hand, if you're being very productive and getting everything you want done, it doesn't allow for creativity oftentimes because you get too in your head and you get too fixated on the perfectionism of it. And I myself am guilty of being a perfectionist. So yeah, just that balance of creativity and productivity.
I feel like one of the biggest challenges I have faced as an artist is accepting my style. I'm an abstract artist and abstraction is something hard to understand. And I often find the challenge of explaining to my viewers or audience, they often want to see my drawing and they see, oh, what is this? What is this supposed to be? And I feel like with realism, it's not, you know, people often don't ask that question because they see, you know, what the drawing is supposed to be or the painting. And with abstraction, there's this interpretation that's open up to the viewer. And this is what I love about abstraction, that, you know, what one person sees can be something completely different than another person sees. And it's just opened up for like this great interpretation of like the person standing in front of the drawing or the painting. And this is something that I really enjoy with abstraction.
We don't really get, or some of us don't get, the positive reactions, and kind of makes us feel conflicted. And definitely this year, 2020, robbed us all of something, and that year was hard to stay positive. I lost motivation while I couldn't really do the things that gave me inspiration, like seeing the people I loved or doing my favorite outdoor activities and going to cultural events that I kind of look forward to every year. And that was a big source of inspiration for me. But the biggest challenge is myself. I tend to have a lot of doubt and I have this fear that my work won't not be good enough, but I won't be able to communicate what I want to whoever views it. And I think my goal is to hopefully make people of all ages, all types of people, either see the message or definitely appreciate it.
I also get inspired by the history of my Mexican heritage as I learn new things about it every day. From the beautiful beginnings of my native ancestors to the modern diverse world of Mexico, where many cultures work in unison. Finally, the biggest part of my inspiration is my dreams. I dream multiple times a day. They feel so real and vivid. My dreams are the reason why I primarily draw in pen. Because I dream in black and white, it's the best medium that goes well with the inspiration of my dreams. Definitely COVID has impacted my inspiration because of social isolation, quarantine has put upon everyone. But it also inspired me to take a series involving that feeling of isolation and anxiety the pandemic brought. I would say a lot of the challenges are primarily internal. The constant battle of anxiety, flow of thoughts, doubts, feeling unworthy. But it's a wave. You can battle through them some days, and other times it's very overwhelming.
I would describe the strongest part of my creative process as just getting out of my head, relinquishing control, just getting into a state where I can truthfully answer these questions to myself, like, how do you feel right now? What's going on in your life? What's worth talking about? what's hard to explain. And just by asking myself those questions, I can begin to see colors I may want to use and images and concepts I may want to create, and sometimes even words that I may want to put in there. So that's probably the most important part of the process.
The strongest part of my creative process is taking a mental note by constantly drawing in my head throughout the day and while I sleep. I like thinking ahead, so as I begin drawing, I have an idea of what I'm going to do. But it never goes as planned, and it's the mistakes where I learn the most. Those mistakes turn into something that I would have never thought about.
An idea sparks, and I try to write it down as soon as I can, because that's not just one idea. It's many possible concepts, and I spend a good amount of time thinking how I can build that concept, how can I change it, what colors can best express it, what should I take off. And this stage of the process might take the most amount of time, but when I start working, I know that I can go into it with confidence, and I have all these ways to go about it, and I can see what fits best for the final piece.
I'm definitely inspired by both of those things. One of the experiences that personally inspired me was just going to college for the first time. I'm completely unaware of what I wanted to do, and being immersed in that feeling of just anxiousness and confusion and feeling lost with what I wanted to be in the world and what I wanted to contribute to the world. And it's such a universal feeling, you know, and especially being an artist, because you don't quite know where you're gonna fit in, even in your own artistic sphere. So I created so much art during that time, just in my dorm room, allowing myself to go through those feelings and listen to them.
I feel like I am inspired by my surroundings and my personal life experiences. Specifically, I see color all the time, and I'm fascinated by color. I like to work with color and through color make this high contrast within my work. So I often see this color that inspires me to start and use on my next piece, and I start creating these color schemes that go along with this color, and that's a part of inspiration to my work.
Sometimes I can be inspired by individuals in my neighborhood, the park, or in a bus, and I wonder what their stories are, and that's when I remind myself that all the people we meet or pass by have their own experiences, and they're all equally significant, and we can learn something from them.
I always get inspired by everyone around me, from the people closest to me to complete strangers. Although we may not talk about art, I enjoy interpreting our conversations about life into my art. One person I've been inspired by is my grandpa. For example, he knows little about art but thinks like an artist. Gave me great advice about gardening once, telling me to take a moment to step back, sit down, and look. He explains this because sometimes you can just get lost in the process. I found that to be the best advice when you're head deep in a drawing and you just need to look at the whole picture.
As far as surroundings, I'm inspired by nature. I'm inspired by the colors that exist in nature, the duality of nature, the duality of people that surround me, the people that love me, really inspire me. Can you share some of the challenges that you have faced as an artist? Yes, some of the challenges that I have faced as an artist have been balancing creativity and productivity. Because on the one hand, if you're in that creative space, you know, where you're allowing yourself to express things free and uninhibited, oftentimes it comes sporadically and it doesn't come when you want it to, or you have to sort of, you know, be out experiencing life and experiencing things outside of yourself. So a lot of times that means you're not being productive and you're not getting as much as you want to get done, because you need to be having those experiences. And then on the other hand, if you're being very productive and getting everything you want done, it doesn't allow for creativity oftentimes, because you get too in your head and you get too fixated on the perfectionism of it. And I myself am guilty of being a perfectionist. So yeah, just that balance of creativity and productivity.
I feel like one of the biggest challenges I have faced as an artist is accepting my style. I'm an abstract artist, and abstraction is something hard to understand. And I often find the challenge of explaining to my viewers or audience, they often want to see my drawing and they see, oh, what is this? What is this supposed to be? And I feel like with realism, it's not, you know, people often don't ask that question because they see, you know, what the drawing is supposed to be or the painting. And with abstraction, there's this interpretation that's open up to the viewer. And this is what I love about abstraction, that, you know, what one person sees can be something completely different than another person sees. And it's just opened up for like this great interpretation of like the person standing in front of the drawing or the painting. And this is something that I really enjoy with abstraction.
We don't really get, or some of us don't get, the positive reactions, and kind of makes us feel conflicted. And definitely this year, 2020, robbed us all of something, and that year was hard to stay positive. I lost motivation while I couldn't really do the things that gave me inspiration, like seeing the people I loved or doing my favorite outdoor activities and going to cultural events that I kind of look forward to every year. And that was a big source of inspiration for me. But the biggest challenge is myself. I tend to have a lot of doubt, and I have this fear that my work won't not be good enough, but I won't be able to communicate what I want to whoever views it. And I think my goal is to hopefully make people of all ages, all types of people, either see the message or definitely appreciate it.
I also get inspired by the history of my Mexican heritage as I learn new things about it every day. From the beautiful beginnings of my native ancestors to the modern diverse world of Mexico, where many cultures work in unison. Finally, the biggest part of my inspiration is my dreams. I dream multiple times a day. They feel so real and vivid. My dreams are the reason why I primarily draw in pen. Because I dream in black and white, it's the best medium that goes well with the inspiration of my dreams. Definitely COVID has impacted my inspiration because of social isolation quarantine has put upon everyone. But it also inspired me to take a series involving that feeling of isolation and anxiety the pandemic brought. I would say a lot of the challenges are primarily internal. The constant battle of anxiety, full of thoughts, doubts, feeling unworthy. But it's a wave. You can battle through them some days, and other times it's very overwhelming.
I would describe the strongest part of my creative process as just getting out of my head, relinquishing control, just getting into a state where I can truthfully answer these questions to myself, like, how do you feel right now? What's going on in your life? What's worth talking about? What's hard to explain? And just by asking myself those questions, I can begin to see colors I may want to use, and images and concepts I may want to create, and sometimes even words that I may want to put in there. So that's probably the most important part of the process.
The strongest part of my creative process is taking a metronome by constantly drawing in my head throughout the day and while I sleep. I like thinking ahead, so as I begin drawing, I have an idea of what I'm going to do. But it never goes as planned. And it's the mistakes where I learn the most. Those mistakes turn into something that I would have never thought about.
An idea sparks, and I try to write it down as soon as I can. Because that's not just one idea, that's many possible concepts. And I spend a good amount of time thinking how I can build that concept, how can I change it, what colors can best express it, what should I take off. And this stage of the process might take the most amount of time, but when I start working, I know that I can go into it with confidence, and I have all these ways to go about it, and I can see what fits best for the final piece.
I'm definitely inspired by both of those things. One of the experiences that personally inspired me was just going to college for the first time. I'm completely unaware of what I wanted to do. And being immersed in that feeling of just anxiousness and confusion and feeling lost with what I wanted to be in the world and what I wanted to contribute to the world. And it's such a universal feeling, you know, and especially being an artist, because you don't quite know where you're gonna fit in, even in your own artistic sphere. So I created so much art during that time, just in my dorm room, allowing myself to go through those feelings and listen to them.
I feel like I am inspired by my surroundings and my personal life experiences. Specifically, I see color all the time, and I'm fascinated by color. I like to work with color and through color make this high contrast within my work. So I often see this color that inspires me to start and use on my next piece, and I start creating these color schemes that go along with this color, and that's a part of inspiration to my work.
Sometimes I can be inspired by individuals in my neighborhood, the park, or in a bus, and I wonder what their stories are, and that's when I remind myself that all the people we meet or pass by have their own experiences, and they're all equally significant, and we can learn something from them.
I always get inspired by everyone around me, from the people closest to me to complete strangers. Although we may not talk about art, I enjoy interpreting our conversations about life into my art. One person I've been inspired by is my grandpa. For example, he knows little about art, but thinks like an artist. He gave me great advice about gardening once, telling me to take a moment to step back, sit down, and look. He explains this because sometimes you can just get lost in the process. I found that to be the best advice when you're head deep in a drawing and you just need to look at the whole picture.
As far as surroundings, I'm inspired by nature. I'm inspired by the colors that exist in nature, the duality of nature, the duality of the people that surround me, the people that love me, really inspire me. Can you share some of the challenges that you have faced as an artist? Yes. Some of the challenges that I have faced as an artist have been balancing creativity and productivity. Because on the one hand, if you're in that creative space, you know, where you're allowing yourself to express things free and uninhibited, oftentimes it comes sporadically and it doesn't come when you want it to, or you have to sort of, you know, be out experiencing life and experiencing things outside of yourself. So a lot of times that means you're not being productive and you're not getting as much as you want to get done because you need to be having those experiences. And then on the other hand, if you're being very productive and getting everything you want done, it doesn't allow for creativity oftentimes because you get too in your head and you get too fixated on the perfectionism of it. And I myself am guilty of being a perfectionist. So yeah, just that balance of creativity and productivity.
I feel like one of the biggest challenges I have faced as an artist is accepting my style. I'm an abstract artist, and abstraction is something hard to understand. And I often find the challenge of explaining to my like viewers or audience, they often want to see my drawing and they see, oh, what is this? What is this supposed to be? And I feel like with realism, it's not, you know, people often don't ask that question because they see, you know, what the drawing is supposed to be or the painting. And with abstraction, there's this interpretation that's open up to the viewer. And this is what I love about abstraction, that, you know, what one person sees can be something completely different than another person sees. And it's just opened up for like this great interpretation of like the person standing in front of the drawing or the painting. And this is something that I really enjoy with abstraction.
We don't really get, or some of us don't get, the positive reactions, and kind of makes us feel conflicted. And definitely this year, 2020, robbed us all of something, and that year was hard to stay positive. I lost motivation while I couldn't really do the things that gave me inspiration, like seeing the people I loved or doing my favorite outdoor activities and going to cultural events that I kind of look forward to every year. And that was a big source of inspiration for me. But the biggest challenge is myself. I tend to have a lot of doubt, and I have this fear that my work won't not be good enough, but I won't be able to communicate what I want to whoever views it. And I think my goal is to hopefully make people of all ages, all types of people, either see the message or definitely appreciate it.
I also get inspired by the history of my Mexican heritage as I learn new things about it every day. From the beautiful beginnings of my native ancestors to the modern diverse world of Mexico, where many cultures work in unison. Finally, the biggest part of my inspiration is my dreams. I dream multiple times a day. They feel so real and vivid. My dreams are the reason why I primarily draw in pen. Because I dream in black and white, it's the best medium that goes well with the inspiration of my dreams. Definitely COVID has impacted my inspiration because of social isolation quarantine has put upon everyone. But it also inspired me to take a series involving that feeling of isolation and anxiety the pandemic brought. I would say a lot of the challenges are primarily internal. The constant battle of anxiety, flow of thoughts, doubts, feeling unworthy. But it's a wave. You can battle through them some days, and other times it's very overwhelming.
I would describe the strongest part of my creative process as just getting out of my head, relinquishing control, just getting into a state where I can truthfully answer these questions to myself, like, how do you feel right now? What's going on in your life? What's worth talking about? What's hard to explain? And just by asking myself those questions, I can begin to see colors I may want to use, and images and concepts I may want to create, and sometimes even words that I may want to put in there. So that's probably the most important part of the process.
The strongest part of my creative process is taking a metronome by constantly drawing in my head throughout the day while I sleep. I like thinking ahead, so as I begin drawing, I have an idea of what I'm going to do. But it never goes as planned. And it's the mistakes where I learn the most. Those mistakes turn into something that I would have never thought about.
An idea sparks, and I try to write it down as soon as I can. Because that's not just one idea. It's many possible concepts, and I spend a good amount of time thinking how I can build that concept, how can I change it, what colors can best express it, what should I take off. And this stage of the process might take the most amount of time, but when I start working, I know that I can go into it with confidence, and I have all these ways to go about it, and I can see what fits best for the final piece.
I'm definitely inspired by both of those things. One of the experiences that personally inspired me was just going to college for the first time. I'm completely unaware of what I wanted to do. And being immersed in that feeling of just anxiousness and confusion and feeling lost with what I wanted to be in the world and what I wanted to contribute to the world. And it's such a universal feeling, you know, and especially being an artist, because you don't quite know where you're gonna fit in, even in your own artistic sphere. So I created so much art during that time, just in my dorm room, allowing myself to go through those feelings and listen to them.
I feel like I am inspired by my surroundings and my personal life experiences. Specifically, I see color all the time, and I'm fascinated by color. I like to work with color and through color make this high contrast within my work. So I often see this color that inspires me to start and use on my next piece, and I start creating these color schemes that go along with this color, and that's a part of inspiration to my work.
Sometimes I can be inspired by individuals in my neighborhood, the park, or in a bus, and I wonder what their stories are, and that's when I remind myself that all the people we meet or pass by have their own experiences, and they're all equally significant, and we can learn something from them.
I always get inspired by everyone around me, from the people closest to me to complete strangers. Although we may not talk about art, I enjoy interpreting our conversations about life into my art. One person I've been inspired by is my grandpa. For example, he knows little about art, but thinks like an artist. He gave me great advice about gardening once, telling me to take a moment to step back, sit down, and look. He explains this because sometimes you can just get lost in the process. I found that to be the best advice when you're head deep in a drawing and you just need to look at the whole picture.
As far as surroundings, I'm inspired by nature. I'm inspired by the colors that exist in nature, the duality of nature, the duality of the people that surround me, the people that love me, really inspire me. Can you share some of the challenges that you have faced as an artist? Yes. Some of the challenges that I have faced as an artist have been balancing creativity and productivity. Because on the one hand, if you're in that creative space, you know, where you're allowing yourself to express things free and uninhibited, oftentimes it comes sporadically and it doesn't come when you want it to, or you have to sort of, you know, be out experiencing life and experiencing things outside of yourself. So a lot of times that means you're not being productive and you're not getting as much as you want to get done because you need to be having those experiences. And then on the other hand, if you're being very productive and getting everything you want done, it doesn't allow for creativity oftentimes because you get too in your head and you get too fixated on the perfectionism of it. And I myself am guilty of being a perfectionist. So yeah, just that balance of creativity and productivity.
I feel like one of the biggest challenges I have faced as an artist is accepting my style. I'm an abstract artist, and abstraction is something hard to understand, and I often find the challenge of explaining to my like viewers or audience. They often want to see my drawing and they see, oh, what is this? What is this supposed to be? And I feel like with realism, it's not, you know, people often don't ask that question because they see, you know, what the drawing is supposed to be or the painting. And with abstraction, there's this interpretation that's open up.
Hello, hello. I'm going to hope that everyone out there in Cyberland can hear me. My name is Jonathan Pope Evans. I am the Associate Professor of Theater here at Los Angeles Southwest College. And I want to take a couple of minutes before I introduce the show. And I want to, this is really cool. This is the first time we're using this hop-in platform and I'm loving it. Oh my God. Okay. So a couple of things that I want to say in the beginning, I think are very important. And the first thing I want to say is I want to give a round of applause to the wonderful art majors and the wonderful and amazing Lauren Evans, who is also an associate professor here at Los Angeles Southwest College. She's the associate professor of art and she's absolutely amazing. People think we're somehow related or twins or something. We're not, although I wouldn't mind being her brother, right? The second thing I want to bring attention to is I wore my fancy jacket, which you'll notice for tonight's performance. I've been called a magician before whilst wearing this jacket. And the last time I wore it was when my wonderful drama team was able to perform live at the Region 8 American College Theater Festival back last year in February of 2020. And I purposely haven't put it on until tonight because, you know, we are here to celebrate and also address some things that are very dark that are happening still in our country. But there are a couple of things to really uplift us. And tonight we're going to talk about, you know, the positive things that are happening as well as what has happened, which has been very dark and very upsetting to many people, to all of us here tonight, I'm sure. So the first thing I want to do is celebrate the team and say that I'm so proud of this group of people. They're amazing artists. They're artists who have inspired me, artists who have made me want to get up and do more theater and work with this whole Zoom craziness. This group has really stepped up to the plate, as you'll see, and they have just been awarded the Outstanding Ensemble Award at the latest American College Theater Festival, which this year was all virtual. And so we didn't quite know how we were going to really handle this virtual thing. But we're here we are, and I think that they did an amazing, amazing job. This group of actors is one of the best I've ever had, and the fact that we were able to pull off this show at all is a miracle, and I'm so proud of them, and I couldn't be prouder. I'm such a Papa Bear right now, and I'm feeling so proud of the work that they've done tonight, and I can't wait to share it with you. So, in case any of you were wondering also, I'm in my daughter's room, and she likes reptiles. And so you can see back here is a chameleon atrium type device, right? And so if you're wondering what's back there, no, it's not Silence of the Lambs. I'm not like hoarding anybody's, you know, I'm not hoarding anything back there except a chameleon. And so, yeah, let's me stop talking. I do want to celebrate the students tonight, and I want to celebrate the life of George Floyd and the legacy he left behind. And that is something to celebrate, and to be able to address social justice issues, I believe, would have made him very proud. And I think that if he could have met this wonderful group of students and see what they've created from his life and from his legacy, I believe that that would make him, would have made him very proud. And I believe he's up there watching us. And I believe that he would be proud and is proud of this wonderful batch of students. So we have some live performances after the presentation, and we have actually some breakout rooms. I want to kind of throw you guys in a breakout room with one of the actors, and you get to ask questions about the process. We also get to brainstorm about what social justice looks like in the next stage of our American history. What's the next step in what social justice looks like in the world? And so without further ado, let me again stop all my jibber-jabber talking, and let's enjoy the Los Angeles Southwest College's production, their newest production. I'm so proud of them. Their newest production entitled George Floyd.
Silence.
Hi again, everyone. I think, first of all, I don't need any more stage time, so I'm not looking for that. I think we actually do have some technical difficulty going on, and I'm going to defer to my wonderful event coordinator here at Los Angeles Southwest College. Jen, if you could just let me know when you might have finessed the sound issue. I apologize. There is sound throughout the whole show. It's only 20 minutes long, but it does have sound. So I'm going to just see if Jen can sort of let me know when she may have it up and running, and then we can just start back from the beginning. And in the meantime, what I thought I could talk about are some of the wonderful students that are involved in this production. First of all, the writer, all the students wrote it together, right? And I always want the students to create everything by themselves. I just sort of sit back and watch them. But, you know, one of the main writers of the piece, his name is Philip Jones. And Phil has been with the team for probably 3-4 years now, I think. He has been such an integral part of what we've been doing. He dedicates his very soul to the work that we're doing. And he really had the idea of sort of taking this George Floyd story and expanding it into something dramatic and something very moving. And I remember we were talking about this piece, and I said, what do you think the audience doesn't know about George Floyd? Can you create something from that question? What do you think the audience doesn't already know? And how could we expand this, you know, this, obviously we've seen the horrific video, but how can the piece be more than just a video? How do we take something and expand that into a show, into, you know, 20 minutes? And from that question, I think, you know, Phil created a lot of the text, and it's really beautiful. And later, of course, everyone else wrote a lot of stuff in there as well. Are we ready to go? I'm winging it out here, which I, of course, don't mind. But I think people are very tired of hearing me talk. Is that okay? Jen says she thinks that we're ready. So I'm going to head out. And once again, please enjoy the Los Angeles Southwest College's Experimental Theater Laboratories production of George Floyd. Okay, I'm back again. I think we've all become accustomed to the beginning of the piece now. We've seen it a couple of times. So I'm going to continue talking until, again, my amazing team lets me know when we're sort of ready to work here and ready to show it. You know what? We can take a moment to talk about, some things I think that have happened recently. That have actually been positive. I know that much of the Minneapolis Police Department since the George Floyd incident has worked on reformation of the department. I know that it hasn't been as extensive as a lot of the activists would like, but there has been some reform, some police reform, and some internal management that have been changed, and some people have been let go, and I think there have been some internal shifts that have happened because of a lot of the recent horrific things that have been happening and the murders that have been happening. And so I think one thing that a lot of the students talked about throughout the process was, what does the solution look like, right? It's one thing to create artistic work about travesty, murder, but what is sort of the next step? And that's one thing I wanted us to all talk about with each other after watching the piece, is what is part of the solution? What is the next step of the conversation of social justice? Reformation of the police, reformation of the entire criminal justice system would be one, I would imagine. But there are other things we can do as a community. So Jen, do you want to jump in here maybe and let us know how you're doing? Okay, I think she's still working on it. I think another thing we could talk about is the fact that we started with a much larger piece, which was, I think, much more centered around the overall conversation across America that's being had about criminal justice reform. I heard something. Are you guys hearing this? I can hear it now.
Those eight okay. minutes, 46
seconds. So can we, okay, now I think we're working.
Eight.
Okay, can we start it over, please?
And okay, please. Get out of here. Please, the knee of my dick. I can't breathe shit.
Bro, get in the car, man. Get in the car.
Mama.
Get up and get in the car right.
I can't.
Those 8 minutes and 46 seconds felt like 8 years.
I can't breathe. Please, the knee of my dick. Can't breathe shit.
Bro, get up, get in the car, man. Bro, get up, get in the car.
Mama.
Get up, get in
Mama.
The car, right?
I can't.
A flat line, a silence, a sickness fell across the land. A flat line. Silence.
A flat
a sickness fell across
silence.
The land. A flat line.
Fell
a silence. A sickness fell across the land.
My neck. My neck. They're trying to kill me, man. Mama! They're trying to kill us.
A flat line. A flat line. A flat line.
COVID-19. The sickness that put the world to sleep. And then, one horrific murder set the world on fire again.
But what is the American sickness that we suffer from?
Mama!
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 Mama! You can't get y'all an opportunity to get in, bro. You can't win.
My knee.
You can't win, man.
I'm through.
I know you're a nephew.
What's up, y'all? It's your boy, Big Floyd. They also call me Perry. I'm here hollering at you. Hey, what's up out there in Cyberland? I hope y'all got safe. My story. Yeah, I can tell you my story. I'm just not sure if you want to hear the real story. Now I see things so much different than before. It all makes sense to me now. You know, the bigger picture, the broad strokes of American history and how it looks from far away. You see, y'all know my name now. And I'm more than just George now. I'm a billboard, a t-shirt, a crying chant on the city street making a difference in people's lives, you feel me? That ain't what I intended to be. And I know y'all sitting there thinking about the most horrific 8 minutes and 46 seconds of my life.
A flat line, a silence, a sickness.
That's what comes to mind when you hear my name or see my face. That ain't what I intended to be.
That's some bum ass shit, bro. That's some bum ass shit, bro.
Do you know me? Do you know me?
May 25th, 2020. Minneapolis police officers arrested George Floyd, a 46-year-old black man.
7:50 p.m. George Floyd and his friend exit a local convenience store and they get into their vehicle. 7:55 p.m. The two employees of the convenience store notices that the $20 bill that George Floyd had used appears to have been a counterfeit. They exit the store and across the street to his car to confront George Floyd. At 8:08 p.m., two officers arrive, and 8:09 p.m., they exit and make their way across the street to George Floyd's vehicle. At 8:12 p.m., the officers place George on the ground against the wall.
8 minutes and 46 seconds.
At 8:14 p.m., an altercation between the officers ends with George Floyd on the ground. At 8:17 p.m., a third officer vehicle arrives. Officers Derek Chauvin and Zhou Tao, they join the arresting officers. At 8:25 p.m., bystanders confront the officers about George's unresponsive condition.
There, they found George Floyd beneath three police officers.
Sometimes. Ooh. Now, I know I got my shortcomings. I want to get that clear. I ain't better than nobody else, but police, man, all these shootings that's going on. For the love of God, police, y'all have to put those guns down. That ain't what it is. I'm not the dude that man tried to make me out to be that day when they called cops on me for that counterfeit bill. Whether that bill was counterfeit or not, that ain't why I'm here to talk to y'all. I come here to tell you my story goes way back, honestly, before I was even born. I represent all those little black boys and little black girls that ain't got no chance because they was given no chance. I was just this big old dude, this big old heart. I see it all so much more clearly now. I ain't in pain no more. I ain't never gonna be in pain again.
Is my breath such a threat that you wanna snap my neck? Why don't you want me to breathe?
I probably never had a true shot at making it in this world the same way a lot of other people may have had it. So let's go back and take a look at the past generations of my family. Hillary Thomas Stewart was my great-grandfather. He was born a slave. He did not become a free man and get his free papers until the ripe old age of 8 years old. He had a hard life, I'm telling you. You know, the arc of the Floyd family is so similar to so many Americans, man. They were formerly enslaved people who were freed after the Civil War, but then left to figure out life on their own. How to build a life and a future.
I think I did pretty good for my time. And nothing like on the land. Yeah, boy. On the land is like owning a legacy. You can leave it behind for your children, for the babies. Once upon a time, I owned a lot of land. Yeah. Yes, sir. Did pretty good.
They used to call them the rich niggas. That's how they used to refer to my family. But then the land was stolen from them. Just like so many other African-American families living in the Jim Crow South, white men in North Carolina took what they wanted. Story was, you know, he was illiterate. He couldn't read and write. Then through deception and fraud of white officials, taxes and things, man, he didn't have a chance. He did not have a chance. Bro, explain something to me. If my great-great-grandfather had his land stolen because he wasn't allowed to read and write, and then my great-grandfather ended up poor as well because of it, and then everyone else down the line afterwards, what type of situation do you think I'm gonna be in when it's my chance? Yo, we were affected generations before we were even born. Look, I'm here to let y'all know that what we've been doing all this time is wrong. And in order for the world to be right, things have got to change. You feel me? So check this out. In 1977, my mother moved my siblings and I to Houston, Texas. She wanted to put the tobacco fields behind her. When she arrived in Houston, the most accessible place for a poor woman with three children to find housing was the CUNY homes.
that was public housing in Houston back then. You see, my belief is that through everything my family went through before my time and before my siblings' time, they found a way to be good, good people. And I believe it starts and ends with that. Them being the wonderful people that they are. You know, I mean, we may not have had everything that we wanted, but we had clothes on our back, food in our stomachs, a roof over our head. And the love that every child should have from their parents and family. See, what some people don't understand is that just being there for someone can take the place of a whole lot of things.
When I saw that video, as a black man, you know.
As a human, when I saw the video, I felt...
I didn't feel safe.
It just shook me to my core.
I felt as if I wasn't just watching this video, but I was watching years and years and years of black men and women being murdered.
Do you know me? Do you know me?
And I always had me wondering, like, that could have been me.
How is this still happening?
Sometimes I walk outside not knowing if I'm going to make it back alive.
I haven't done anything but be born. I don't feel like playing nice today.
For a second, I understood why people wanted to burn things down.
Mama!
You see, some folk was given this in life long before they was even born. They was cast in this here movie before they even knew it was a movie. It's just the way America is painted. Like a strange, flawed Monet. All blurry. When you stand up close. But when you stand far away, when you fly high above it, you see the truth of it, what it really is. Like a motherless
child. Those 8 minutes and 46 seconds felt like 8 years. As I just felt my life just leaving my body.
Silence.
Until I just gave up and stopped breathing. I remember thinking to myself, fuck! I can't be dying today. Fuck! Am I gonna die? Y'all love on y'all kids. Big Floyd out.
We will not be silent anymore. We will stand for the fallen men and women. Silence.
I know you're out there, and I know that you are watching on your screens. Let's do something together. Take somebody's hand that you're sitting next to right now. Go ahead. Now, what we're going to do is stand up for George Floyd. Come on, stand. And as you're standing, hold the hands that you're holding and hold those hands up right now. Come on. Hold those hands up. You are a pivotal part of changing this world and ending this tyranny. Stand up. Say his name. Say who it is. Say George Floyd.
Hi, everyone. So welcome back. Often there's kind of a moment after the pieces that we create where I would say people are a bit unsure how to respond. Usually our work is about injustice and often about murder, often about history, and how that's sort of woven together. So sometimes it takes kind of a minute to come out of that. It's not like with some shows you can just sort of go out after and be chipper and hang out. Sometimes you have to process. I hope that you have a lot of questions for the group. I hope you will be excited to meet them. I hope you're not going to go away. We have some live performances now that are going to be really exciting. Some original music that will hopefully lift our spirits as we honor George Floyd and his legacy and what he's left behind. And really what tonight I think is most about, not just the work that the students have done, which is wonderful and significant, but to allow ourselves to take a moment to realize where we are in American history and realize what work needs to be done now as we move forward, especially in an age that's filled with COVID and digital spaces and virtual performances. What do we do to continue the work to fight for and end the genocide of African Americans, to move forward and find equality, to move forward and be able to address the murder and the genocide of the past, and be able to really see a new future, and be able to move past the past, and move into a new future. And I think that's one significant moment that we want to address tonight, is what do we see now that we are acknowledging a lot of the past atrocities and murders? What can we do to move forward together? So I want to hopefully lift the energy up a little bit, and I would like to put in an original performance. This is a song written by the man who played George Floyd, the amazing Ramon Thomas, everyone. Cyber applause. He wrote a few different tracks. This track is called Seven Bullets, and I believe that he will be accompanied by two other performers, Anthony Oakes, who I'm very happy to meet for the first time and to have involved in our group, and Ursula Rayford, who's been in the group for many years now, and she was one of the original ensemble members, right? And so she's going to be accompanying Raymond as well as we do a live performance of Seven Bullets. Can we get into that? Are you guys ready? Yay! Music! Hopefully.
Well, hello, my name is Anthony Oakes. I think we're just waiting on Ramon and our other performer.
Hi, Anthony.
Hi, how are you, Jonathan? Can you hear me?
I can hear you. I think we're the only ones in here, so I thought, hey, you know, let's hang out for a minute while we get our, there's Ramon. Amazing. I'm so glad you guys are here. So I'm going to leave you alone. Unless, are we waiting for Ursula? Do we want to wait for her before I jump out of here? Well, how you doing, Anthony? It's good to meet you.
The pleasure is all mine, Jonathan. I appreciate this opportunity. I'm super proud of Ramon and the entire team. This was a wonderful production thus far, and I'm really looking forward to performing.
That's amazing. I'm so glad you're here to work with everyone. And again, Ramon, the amazing Ramon, I say this all the time, he's a genius, right? I get tired of hearing him, I harass him, and I compliment him.
He's amazing, though. He is amazing.
Yeah. So he is amazing, and now we get to hear some music. Ramon, while we're waiting for Ursula, maybe you could just tell us. Oh, there she is. Okay, then I won't talk anymore. Okay.
Hi, guys.
The Seven Bullets. Enjoy.
Oops, sorry. Okay, here we go. I promise that's the last technical difficulty of the night.
Don't hold me to that. Seven bullets and there's just one guy. Paralyzed at the bottom, now his whole life is shot.
another cry for his mama and a whole nation burn. How many bodies does it take to get some people to learn? 7 bullets and it's just what one got. Paralyzed at the bottom, man, his whole life is shot. Another cry for his mama and a whole nation burn. How many bodies would it take to get some people to learn?
We got mama's crying. While they turn a blind eye on the side, on the blind side. 40 acres and a mule, I never got. I think it's about time. Now imagine that. I guess they said they had a strap for furnace. Then that's a known fact.
Six. How can you fix a broken system? Burn it down. 5. Can't survive. Why is it so hard for blacks to stay alive? 4. Just for breathing. 4. Just for eating. 4. Just for sleeping. 3. 3 wishes to live, 2 fucks to give. Now I'm all the way back to 1, and all these proud black mamas still losing. 7 bullets, and it's just what one got. Paralyzed at the bottom, now his whole life is shot. Another cry for his mama and a whole nation burned. How many bodies does it take to get some people to learn? 7 bullets and it's just what one got. Paralyzed at the bottom, man, his whole life is shot. Another cry for his mama and a whole nation burned. How many bodies does it take to get some people to learn?
Rihanna, bitch, better have my justice. Jesus be a fence, or Jesus bring the ruckus. American magician, sleight of hand, pay attention. Prayer without action makes Ahmad a dead man. Hut 1, hut 2, what is marching gonna do? You better march to these
boots.
Hey, I keep telling them, hey, I keep yelling it, hey. They're just jealous of this melody.
Together. And no matter the weather, we've got wings to fly. When we march this road together, there's no height we can't climb. And no matter the weather, we've got wings to fly. When we march this road together, there's no height we cannot climb. And no matter the weather, we've got wings to fly. Oh, we must just roll together.
Wow. Wonderful. I'm going to give you an applause just because I can't help myself. You guys are brilliant. You guys are amazing.
Thank you.
I've never heard that all the way through with the rapping in there and the addition of that. I was really moved, and I kept thinking as I was watching it, I was like, I want the track to that. Where's the iTunes? Where do I pay for the iTunes, people? That's really a hot, it's great. You know, there's that song America by Childish Gambino, you know. It has a little kind of reminiscent flavor of that, but it's totally original. The rapping and the music and everything is so great. We got to get that on iTunes. We got to get that on somewhere so people can pay for that. That's fantastic. Again, I love it. Wonderful job. Now, I'm going to take it down for a little bit, just for a few minutes. We're not going to do this for very long, but I wanted to take about 10 minutes, and I've assigned every audience member to a cast member. And what I thought we could do for really just 10 minutes, right? 9 or 10 minutes. You get to really talk one-on-one with the performer and ask questions about the process. But also, I would love to start a discussion, if we can, you know, like Anthony's rap said, you know, what's going to happen now? You know, yes, we've marched. Yes, we've created this conversation. But what do we really have to do to create that change? What's the next step? And I'd love to hear feedback. That might influence our future piece, which might be the next, what we see as the next chapter in social justice reform. So, Jen, can we take it to the breakout rooms? You're just going to get thrown in there. Please don't leave. Just talk, right? And let's take about 10 minutes to discuss the piece. I'm not sure what's happening, but I'm thinking it's going. I'm thinking it's happening.
All right. Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. So on the left side of your screen is an icon that says session. So it says reception, stage, sessions. So you would click into the sessions. I will drop into the chat for you all the rooms that you have each been assigned to. So as Professor Evans said, we'll be there for about 10 minutes, so until, let's say, about 8 o'clock, and then we will come back to the stage area. So give me just a moment. I'll drop those into the chat, and have a great discussion. Thanks, all.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay, I'm still not super clear on what's happening.
So we click on sessions, right?
Sessions, I think, and then it's got like discussion with Farah, discussion with Sarah. You can click which room you go to. I'm going to click Ursula's room.
Are you currently, you are currently on video, then this page will remove you from the video.
Hi, guys. Well, I've been kind of floating around in, I feel like this, I've been lost in cyberspace, quite frankly. I think I got lost. I was like in the closet somewhere. Well, not in the closet, as clearly many of you know. But I was trapped somewhere. I was under a mattress. I don't know what was happening, but I was. Were you guys having a great discussion? I hope so. And I would love to hear about your discussions at another time, because right now I want to move on and have some great live performance and more singing. So without further ado, again, I hope you had some really fruitful conversations in your breakout rooms. Please share those with me, or please share in the chat if you have something you want to jump in there and say. But I would like to hear some more music. So I might have to get back to our conversations a little bit later. I have a great performer coming up next for you. Her name is Farah Diggs Adamu, and I call her Oshun. That's sort of the name I would like to call her. She can explain what Oshun means as her nickname. And she's an amazing performer. She's an amazing singer. She's an amazing everything. Makes me very happy just to hear her voice and see her. And much of her music, you got to hear her voice. Much of the piece was underscored by her music. And she and Ramon actually collaborated to create a lot of the sounds that you heard underneath the piece. So we're going to have Farah come up and on the stage and perform a song that Ramon has written called Let the People See. I believe. I think we're going to see that. Farah, are you there? I don't know if Farah is here. It might be just us, everyone, but I would love some more live singing. Well, why don't we jump to Ursula? And I know that's a little bit out of order, but Ursula would like to perform now. So while we figure out what's going on with Farah, maybe Ursula, you want to jump up and do your spoken word? Ursula, of course, the amazing spoken word artist, rapper, actress, superstar, rock star, hip hop star. Ursula, how you doing? You ready? Or someone? Okay, I don't see anyone else out here on stage. So in the meantime, I'm just gonna keep talking. First of all, I couldn't be more... Okay, Jen says, I was going to say, I couldn't be more honored to work with these young performers. But now I see that Sarah can go. So Jen, we're just going to let whoever can perform, jump up there and perform. So Sarah is also a brilliant performer that I met a few years ago. Sarah Nienke, everyone. An amazing voice, an amazing talent, an amazing actress, an amazing, 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 amazing everything. So thank you, Sarah, for coming and performing live for us. I'm going to let you take it away.
Thank you so much, JP. Thank you, everyone, for being here tonight. It's a very special night for all of us here, and we appreciate the support, especially via Zoom. this cyber web, like JP says, is definitely a whirlwind. My name is Sarah Yenke. I've been with the LASC Theater Lab for quite a while. I was introduced by a friend to JP, and it was a pleasure. It's been a roller coaster, but it's been challenging and uplifting and rewarding. So those are definitely the words I can speak of that I'm so profoundly grateful for being a part of this group. Without any further ado, let's go ahead and start. Please let me know if you can hear me. If not, we'll get this rolling.
I've been walking with my face turned to the sun. Weight on my shoulders, ooh, a bullet in my gun. Oh, I got eyes in the back of my head, just in case I have to run. I do what I can when I can, while I can for my people. All the stars roll back and the clouds fill the night. That's when I'm gonna stand up. Take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home. Far across the river, can you hear people calling, calling me to answer? Gonna keep on keeping on. I can feel it in my bones. Yeah. Oh, early in the morning, before the sun begins to shine, we're gonna start moving towards that separating line. Oh, I went through muddy waters. You know I gotta make up my mind. And I don't mind if I lose any blood on the way to salvation. And I'll fight with the strength that I got until I die. So I'm gonna stand up. People with me, together we are going to a brand new home. Far across the river, can you hear freedom calling, calling me to answer? Gonna keep on keeping on. And I know what's around the bend might be hard to face, cause I'm alone and I just might fail. But Lord knows I tried. Touring stars filled up the sky. Oh, to a brand new home. Can you hear freedom calling? Gonna keep on keeping on. I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home. Far across the river, you hear people calling, calling me to answer. Gonna keep it on. I'm gonna stand up, take my people with me. Together we are going to a brand new home. The river calling me to answer. Gonna keep on keeping on. I can feel it in
prepare our lips for you. I go to prepare our lips for you. I go to prepare our lips for you.
Thank you.
Amazing. I hope everybody can see me right now. I'm so moved. Sarah's such a talent, and I'm so blessed to have been able to work with her for the past couple of years in the ensemble. So many great performers that are part of the group. I'm really honored and humbled. And Sarah's heart is so huge, and it matches her talent. That's what I'm going to say. Talent huge, heart huge. Before we move on, we're going to jump into some other performances. Sarah, what would be the one piece of advice for anybody out there that was thinking of joining the group? What have you learned, or what would be a piece of advice like you might give them to jump in there and do it?
Do it. Even if it scares you, even if you feel like you can't keep up, even if you feel like your limitations, any limitations that you have, you think that they stop you, they won't. And trust me on that. I was scared, I was nervous, I was intimidated, but I stayed, and I'm very grateful that I stayed. Because
and I just think you're an amazing woman, an amazing talent, and I'm glad you could be here while we celebrate the legacy and the life of George Floyd tonight. And thank you so much. I want to get through some other performances, so thank you, Sarah. But can we jump to Farrah? Is that pop? I'm trying to. Okay, I think maybe I lost my video. Yes, Farrah can go next. Yay, Farrah! How are you, honey? You look fantastic, except now I think I lost your video. I can't see your video. Did I lose you? Can everybody else see Farrah? Or maybe my video's out. No. Okay, so I'm gonna keep talking because I'm gonna assume that I am live. And while we try to get Farrah up here, I'm looking at the chat, I'm not sure what happened, but I would say Farrah and I met probably 2 years ago. And I remember seeing her sing at an event, and I remember just being like, that talent. I am going to train her how to act, and I'm going to work with her. She's amazing. And cut to 2 or 3 years, I don't know how long, it's been a long time. Cut to 2 or 3 years later, we're still performing together. And again, I'm honored to have the talent of Farrah here tonight and in the show. And so, I'm hoping that she comes up soon. I'd rather you hear her sing than hear me talk. Okay. Yay! You look gorgeous, honey. I'm not going to talk because I don't want to risk any more technical difficulties. So everyone, this is the amazing Farrah Diggs Adamu, and maybe she can tell you a little bit about why I call her Oshun before the song, or you can just jump into the song. It's up to you.
Okay. Can you guys hear me? Hello? Can you hear me? Can anybody hear me? Can you guys hear me? Let me see. Yes.
Okay. Jen says yes.
Okay, good. So yes, my name is Farrah Diggs Adamu. And I'm so happy to be here this evening celebrating the life of George Floyd with my fellow theater mates and our wonderful illustrious professor, Mr. JPE. And I just want to say congratulations to everyone. And again, our professor and my theater mates for participating in this wonderful short film that we created. I'm always so excited and blessed to be a part of anything that we create together. And I really think, even though we do a lot of great things together, I really think that this one was something very special. All of our pieces are very special, but this one is very near and dear to our hearts because it's so recent and it's still so fresh. And we still are feeling the very serious effects from it. And the things that George Floyd went through, we see it every day. Things that he went through in his life is it's the story of many of our histories still. And so this one is very special to us because of that. So thank you to everyone who is here and who is supporting this project and who supports all of our work. We really do appreciate it from the bottom of our hearts. And just a little bit since you requested. So my name is Faradiz Adamu, but my theater mates and my schoolmates, they call me Oshun because it's a nickname that I assume because of the Yoruban goddess Oshun, who is the goddess of love, the goddess of light, fertility, and everything that's feminine and everything included in love and the creation of love. And creation of the love inside in the human spirit form. So thank you so much. And I'm so glad to be able to share that as well. I'm going to be performing a song called Let the People See. And this song was written by the wonderful Ramon Thomas, who played George Floyd this evening, and myself. And it was produced by Ramon as well. So here we go. Let the people see what some people do. When you stand for right, make sure they hear you. You know it ain't right. How they done me wrong. I've paid the price. Now it won't be long. You said it, Mama. You said it best. Pain, there will be more, for it be less. They done done me, Papa, they done done me wrong. I was the sacrifice. Thank you.
Amazing. Bravo. Amazing. As always, amazing. Beautiful. Amazing woman. I can't believe it. Thank you so much
for your talent, your
contribution. As always, I am blessed that I met you 2 years ago. You never cease to amaze me. And I appreciate your contribution to everything that we do, Farah. It touches my heart. It really does. So let's jump in and let's get Ursula up there, because I think I'm ready for some amazing spoken word action. Ursula, are you there?
Hello.
You know what? I'm going to let you introduce yourself, because you're the one and only Ursula. I think I've sung your praises quite a bit. So I'm going to let you introduce the piece and yourself, and then just rock it. Go for it.
Okay. My name is Ursula Rayford, and this piece is When Will It Stop? Here we go. I watched George Floyd cry. Then I watched George Floyd die as his soul left his body and went up to the sky. Then I bowed my head and prayed, and I asked myself why. Why these police don't have no love and respect? He can't breathe. Get your knee off his neck. He asked you once. He asked you twice as he begged and begged and pleaded for his life. When will all the racism stop? We got to worry about COVID. We got to worry about the cops. It's time to fight back. It's time to make it stop. So I'm stomping in my big black boots. I think it's time that I paid my dues. Unity in the community is the only solution. So jump on the bus and join the revolution. Once a ghetto bandit living half dead, they out there killing brothers and sisters over blue and red. It's time to hang up those rags and throw your fists in the air and start serving black lives in full soldier gear. This is a corrupt world we live in, but I'll be damned if I give in because of the blood spilled by my kin, brutalized by the man. When will it all stop? All this heartache and pain. Whatever you do, please don't forget their names. Rest in peace, George Floyd. Rest in peace, Breonna Taylor. Rest in peace, Trayvon Martin, and all the other senseless killings. Don't forget their names, please. Don't forget their names. Thank you.
Very nice, Ursula. As always, amazing work. Thank you so much for being a part of this evening and bringing your talent. I met you. You were like one of the first people I met at Southwest.
And right.
Made me so happy and impressed me and made me so just smile with all of your talent and your hard work. And once again, you know, you brought it tonight and given such an amazing performance. Thank you so much for being a part of my life and being a part of
Thank you for always having me. It's been a great experience, a great ride. What I would tell anybody is just go for it. You know, we act out the game of life every day. A lot of people fear coming into this, but I just want to say one thing about theater. It's more than just acting. It's very therapeutic. Mm-hmm. You find out so much about yourself. JP will bring it out of you. I swear he'll bring it out of you. You'll face your biggest fears, your worries. Like it's so much more than acting. So just give it a shot if anybody's been wanting to do it. And thank you so much for always having me a part of the productions. Once again, congratulations, Southwest. Have a good night. Thanks everyone for coming.
Thank you for being here. And we have one more performance. I want to try to jump in there. And we have a kind of, I would say, wrap up or a finale to this evening of honoring the life of George Floyd and the legacy of George Floyd. And so I would like to bring back Farah, or AKA Oshun. I'd like to bring back Farah to sing the song that's in the show, Let the People, I'm sorry, Stand Up is the song that's at the end of the show. But I think she'd like to come back and sing it one more time. And I think the idea of kind of a reprise or bringing back the same song again is that we could take a moment to reflect on those things that we talked about in the breakout rooms. We can reflect on some of the things that we saw depicted in the drama and in the video piece. And I think that, you know, if we can come together and create more art that speaks about social justice, if we can go out and vote for the future. future that we want to see, and we can go out and continue to fight for the lives of the young people that don't have a voice out there and may be fearing just going outside of their own door, like some of the actors said in the piece. Let's fight for them and fight for their future and fight for all the people that don't have the platform to speak for themselves. I want to fight for their future, their freedom, and fight for a world where we see an end to the murdering of Black men and women at the hands of the police or anyone else. And that's the future we should fight for and do that together. So as we end tonight's performance, and again, I thank all of you for being here, actors, audience, administrators, other faculty, thank you for your presence, for the, I call it the magic of your presence. When we come together, there's a magic to being together in the same space. Thank you for that. And also for your support of the group for so many years. And I think let's round out the evening by taking a little moment to reflect on what we're here tonight for, which is to honor the spirit, the legacy, and the life of an amazing man, George Floyd. So Farrah, do you want to end our evening and take us out with Stand Up? I think we've lost Farrah, just so everyone knows. I don't want to alarm anyone, but she may be lost in cyberland the way I was before. So we're going to hold for just a second and try to find where Farrah is. And if not, oh, here she comes. Okay, I think she's coming. Yes. Well, once again, the amazing Farrah Diggs Adamu will be performing a final number. And this is a number that was written by a number of people. It was a collaborative number that was written by multiple people in the group. I believe it started with Farrah and Raymond, but then I believe it was also written by Craig, Sarah, and possibly Sharonda and Tiana. I know that there were multiple members of the group that collaborated on this song. It's a real anthem. People love this song. Again, it should be on iTunes. You know, we could sell this thing. And I think it was a great collaborative adventure for the performers to write a song together. And it's called Stand Up. So as soon as we have Farrah, we can hear that, I think. I think she's close to the stage.
Hello.
There she is, beautiful lady. Oh my goodness. I just love your energy right now. We haven't seen each other in so long. I just want to reach through the computer and hug you. It's been such a long time since we got to do that, right? So I will stop talking and let you end the show with the beautiful song, Stand Up.
Okay. Just a little bit, like JP explained, this song was a very organic and collaborative effort between all of the group members. We were sitting in a rehearsal, and we were at the end of rehearsal, and we literally were sitting there like we were in a scene from Sister Act. And we were like, okay, guys, we got to come up with a song. And literally one person, I think it was Tim, Tall Tim, that just started off with the first line, and then Sarah came in with the second line, and then Ramon came in with his line, and I came in with my line, and we added the hook, and it was so organic in that it just, it could do nothing but be perfect. And so it just came out so wonderful. It turned into this wonderful, uplifting piece for our piece. And a wonderful song for the piece, and I'm just so grateful to be able to stand here and perform it for you guys tonight. So here is Stand Up. Take my hand, lead me to the dawn. If you speak for me, my soul will carry on. Nobody wanna see black bodies on the street, 'cause the world sees what they wanna see. No more tears, no more silence, no more fears, no more violence, no more tears, no more silence, no more fears, no more violence. If you wanna change, you can't stay the same. You gotta believe. Stand up, take a look in the mirror. That man in the mirror is you. Stand up for the freedom and the power. Stand up for the freedom and the truth. Stand up, take a look in the mirror. That man in the mirror is you. Stand up for the freedom and the power. Stand up for the freedom and the truth. No more silence, no more peace. No more violence, no more tears. No more silence, no more peace. No more violence. Stand up, 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 stand up. Thank you. Stand up, George Floyd. We won't ever forget you. I can't hear you. Oh, gosh. Unmute yourself if you can.
Okay, you couldn't hear any of that.
So I can hear you now.
I'll say it again. So thank you so much for giving us that song again. I was saying every time I hear it, it just lifts me. And I just want to like sort of dance. I just want to like sing and dance, you know, stand up, stand up, stand up, you know. And every time you do it, I just get all into it. We got to get that on iTunes.
Yes.
But
yes.
Thank you for ending the show for us, Sarah. And to everyone who came tonight, thank you so much for supporting us. We've worked so hard on this show, and I know the students are as grateful as I am that you came to watch it. I think, again, George Floyd would be proud of our work as social activists and as artists, and we're going to continue to do this work. And if you want to join our team, just jump on in. Like Sarah said, you know, and Ursula said, just do it. And join up, and let's make more important work together and keep the message moving forward. So get involved. Let's stay active, and let's have a great evening honoring the legacy and the life of George Floyd. Thank you so much for being here. Good night.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.